It's a genuine pleasure to have been asked to speak to you this morning, although I won't pretend that it felt that way as I made my way to the airport at 5:30. I feel much better now. I'm now well and truly, as you've heard, retired from the movie industry, and only too delighted to have been asked to spend a portion of my retirement serving on the Irish government's digital content task force, working with Barry McSweeney. The vast majority of my work during these past dozen years has been in education and public policy, and I'm particularly proud to be engaged in the development of policy around how we meet and hopefully defeat what may emerge as the greatest challenge the human race has ever faced, the one that we rather limply come to call climate change. But even that has yet to distract me from spending an enormous amount of time continuing to work on education policy because, as I hope will become clear, I see these two strands as, in a very remarkable way, inextricably linked. So this extraordinary fulfilling period of my life has offered the opportunity to engage not simply with climatologists, but with people who every day of their working lives are attempting to mould the building blocks, the quality of which will, in every respect, determine the future of our planet. Those building blocks are, for the most part, primary school children, and the people I've been working with are their teachers. And as I see it, if the future looks increasingly like a war, then this most recent generation of teachers are pretty well the only infantry that I think we've got. A generation of well-trained and confident teachers comfortable with the implications of living in a digital society, but also keenly aware of the huge new challenges that this is likely to bring. It is they, and the children they teach, who to me represent the most promising foundation upon which we can build a sustainable society here in Ireland, or indeed anywhere else in the world in this early part of the 21st century. Now, the war I'm referring to is a war between what I see as our largely failed present and the possibility of an altogether more imaginative future. And it's not simply that I want a more imaginative future, it's more the case that we have no future whatsoever unless we're prepared to be a great deal more imaginative. Inevitably, what this will come down to is a battle between our worst and our better selves. And finding the prospect of playing to my worst instincts deeply unattractive, I've been only too happy to throw my energy into improving the quality, the reputation, and the relevance of education. About a year ago, in order to provoke the debate that I thought was getting stale, I involved myself in making a movie called We Are the People We've Been Waiting For. And if you don't mind, I'm going to show just the opening 5 minutes of it, because I think it serves to at least establish the degree of change that I see necessary and overdue. So we'll just run 5 minutes of this film.
Maybe if you were some spearheaded guy, I would listen to what you have to say.
My number one priority for the next 4 years is to ensure that all Americans have the best education in the world.
Ask me my 3 main priorities for government, and I tell you, education, education, and education.
Children's children, they're the ones to blame. And you say, my daddy will behave. But it's not your day no more. And we are the youth of today. Change your hair in every way. And we are the youth of today. We'll say what we wanna say, and we are the youth of today. Don't care what you have to say at all. And maybe if you had a true point of view, I would listen to you.
The world is facing huge challenges, and they're growing daily in severity, in scale, and in complexity. It's no exaggeration to say that they are not going to go away. Indeed, they will get worse unless we can start to find solutions, and find them soon. If we are going to survive, we desperately need the next generation to be smarter, more adaptable, and better prepared than any that have gone before. Our only chance is to improve the way we teach our young, to equip young people with the skills and attitudes that might steer this world of ours to a far safer place than at present looks likely. The question is that what our current education system does?
On a bit, but you probably, I'm sure, get the point. So if we truly are prepared to take on the genuinely immense challenges of the 21st century, then I believe we've no choice but to embrace the equally immense power of the most recent digital technologies, and to do so in a way that makes our present rate of progress look exactly what it is, that's to say, pitifully inadequate. Let's face it, in many respects, life beyond the school gates in Ireland, as in many other parts of the world, has been quite literally transformed in the past 20 years. Digital technology, whether it's mobiles, the internet, or video games, has fundamentally reshaped the way in which children and young people connect with, make sense of, and engage with society. Rightly or wrongly, these same young people expect an entirely new form of relationship with the world around them, one that doesn't simply rely on accessing information, but on creating new knowledge, new products, and even new resources. Let me offer, if I may, an analogy from the world of the movies. Just a couple of weeks ago, I read a piece in the New York Times which made the following observation about the film industry. Consider how much our world of moving image entertainment has changed just in the past decade. We now live in an era of the 24-hour movie, one that plays any time and any way you want, and sometimes whether you want it or not. It's a movie we can access at home by pressing a few buttons on the remote and agreeing to pay more than you might at the local video store, or more recently, with just a few clicks of the mouse. The 24-hour movie now streams instead of unspools, filling our screens with images that more and more have been created algorithmically rather than photographically. It's my contention that the world of education and learning in a digital society is being similarly transformed. Learning is no longer only something that needs to happen within particular hours, in a particular place, or even with a particular group of people. The immense power of the World Wide Web means that a fantastic knowledge resource is just a click away. In schools, colleges, homes, on the move, anyone with an internet connection has the power to access this quite extraordinary treasure trove of knowledge within literally seconds. Anytime, any place, the world's digital library is quite literally always open. And yet equally, the existence of this extraordinary cornucopia of knowledge also makes the need for teachers and mentors, in essence, trusted learning guides, more crucial than ever. Young people in particular may be very smart about using technology, probably a good deal smarter than most of us. But there are very considerable challenges around helping them to sort the wheat from the chaff, the good from the bad, the valuable from the utterly useless. Helping them to understand the ways in which moving images can distort at the same time as appearing to shape the world around them. In a digital society, access to communication is no longer confined to some small elite. Anyone can join a social network or set up a blog and potentially reach out to other interested souls anywhere in the world. Needless to say, there's a downside. All too often, it feels as though the loudest voices succeed in drowning out the most reasonable, the thoughtful, the moderate, sometimes to a point at which you literally want to scream with frustration. Many of the comments put up in relationship to newspaper articles or video clips on YouTube would appear to demonstrate the presence of a kind of digital lynch mob, a new and increasingly present threat that needs to be vigilantly guarded against. A digital society is, or certainly should be, just that, a society in which we thoughtfully balance our rights with our responsibility to respect and learn from others. Civil society cannot afford to be reduced to some anachronistic free-for-all. Surely, we need to create learning environments in which informed responses to the challenges of the 21st century are encouraged and nurtured. And this would be a world in which prejudice and ignorance would hopefully become rather better understood for exactly what they are. And as I suggested at the outset, the crucial factor in creating this responsible learning environment is a successful and confident educational system. Here's, I think, a fairly telling anecdote from a piece in this month's Atlantic magazine that's entitled What Makes a Great Teacher. On August the 25th, 2008, two little boys walked into public elementary schools in southeast Washington, D.C. Both boys were African-American fifth graders. The previous spring, both had tested well below their grade level in maths. One walked into Kimball Elementary School and climbed the stairs to Mr. William Taylor's maths classroom, a tidy powder blue space in which neither the clocks nor the most of the electrical outlets actually worked. The other walked into a very similar classroom a mile away at Plummer Elementary School. In both schools, more than 80% of the children received free or reduced price lunches. At night, all the children went home to the same urban ecosystem, a zip code in which almost a quarter of the families lived below the poverty line, and a police district in which somebody was murdered pretty well every week. At the end of the school year, both boys took the same standardized test given to all Washington, D.C. public schools. It's not a perfect test of their learning, to be sure, but it's a relatively objective one, and it's worth noting it's not a very difficult one. After a year in Mr. Taylor's class, the first little boy's scores went up, way up. Yes, he'd started below grade level, but he'd finished above it. On average, his classmates' scores rose by 13 points, which is almost 10 points more than fifth graders with similar test scores achieved in other low-income DC schools that year. On that first day of school, only 40% of Mr. Taylor's students were doing maths at grade level. By the end of the year, 90% were at or above it. And how about the other boy? Well, he ended the year the same way he'd started, below grade level. In fact, only a quarter of the fifth graders at Plummer School finished the year at grade level in maths, despite having started off at pretty well the same level as Mr. Taylor's class just down the road. As the article underlines, teachers really matter. And interestingly enough, The Guardian this morning on G2 has a piece about what makes a good teacher. And I must just read you this one. They've asked a number of people what they remember about their teacher and what makes a good teacher. This lovely line from Andrew Motion, who's the former poet laureate. He says, "It was as if he had walked into my head and turned all the lights on. He didn't know what he was doing, but he gave me my life." That's what teachers do. But it's important to remember that it's teachers, not the technology, which makes the crucial difference between raising the bar and it remaining exactly the same depressing place it's always been. Or to be strictly accurate, it's the skilled teacher, adept at handling the very best technology, that's become an asset truly beyond price. And teachers like these will come to matter more than ever in an advanced digital society. In essence, this means putting learning, that's to say the acquisition of understanding, right back where it belongs, at the very centre of our concerns. For if learning finds itself at the heart of the new digital world, then it follows that the type of teachers I'm describing are its lifeblood. In reality, teachers are the keys to all our futures. In fact, without good and confident teachers, I'm not sure we have much of a future at all. And in a world increasingly dominated by Google, Apple, Facebook, and so on, it pays to constantly remind ourselves that no education system in the world can ever be better than the quality of its average teacher. Every piece of social research I've read in the past dozen years affirms and reaffirms that fact. So I don't think the importance of good teaching is likely to change one bit. But I do think that our definition of what makes a good teacher is going to change a very great deal. Of course, leadership, knowledge, the ability to inspire and arouse curiosity, all of those attributes will endure. Teachers will still need to be coaches, colleagues, and friends. But in addition to those qualities, the daily substance of their professional skill base will alter, if for no other reason than to reflect the rapidly changing expectations of their students. And all of this has significant implications for classroom and school management. The model of 30 children in neat rows facing a single teacher is, or ought rapidly to become, an anachronism in an era of video conferencing, whiteboard technology, and social networks. Why shouldn't children be helped to learn French by French children in French schools, or physics by a Nobel Prize winner? And I mention those two because I've seen both happening. Why should teachers still be responsible for lunch hour duty and making sure the PCs work when there are literally armies of volunteers and specialists that could support them in exactly these areas? I should probably pause here in order to be crystal clear about something else. None of the technological developments I've touched upon in any way negates the fundamental need to focus on those reading, writing and mathematical skills which remain at the heart of being able to present oneself as a functioning and informed citizen in an increasingly competitive globalised society. But at the same time, the educational establishment at every level has to take on board a whole set of fundamental truths about the way in which those expectations of young people have changed if we're to deliver learning that, in their eyes, engages and remains fit for purpose over the coming decades. My greatest single concern is that unless education itself moves, then the young people we teach will begin to think that our form of education is an irrelevance to their lives. Let me offer an example from the sphere in which I spent the bulk of my professional life, that of moving images. Anyone born in the developed world since about 1980 has grown up in an environment in which they are increasingly familiar with customising and sharing information and moving images of just about every kind in order to produce their own creative content. That's just one reason why 15 hours of video, both professional and user-generated, are uploaded onto YouTube every single minute. And there's been a 50% increase in the rate at which content's been uploaded in the last 12 months alone, with every sign that this is only going to grow exponentially. Let me offer you another example, this time from the world of interactive games. How many of you are familiar with the game Little Big Planet, which Sony is now targeting on the education market in the US in a very big way? This product is less about traditional game playing and much more about content creation. Sony, at least in the US, is seeking to use Little Big Planet as a platform for the creation and sharing of a whole new approach to learning. It represents a major step forward in game design. In fact, it's barely a game at all. Yet its huge popularity has, in effect, launched PlayStation 3. Now, what these examples help underline is that young people in particular are surrounded by a veritable plethora of moving images of every kind. And only by engaging with these new and at times quite intimidating challenges, and then applying them to the process of teaching and learning, are we likely to produce a generation of creative people with a breadth and depth of understanding that's capable of dealing with this new and quite incredibly difficult century of ours. Actually, we should never cease to remember, it's not ours, it's theirs. Understanding literacy as a term which incorporates a fluid understanding of the moving image as well as the written word allows teachers to promote an extended awareness of narrative and explore meanings, some of which can only be derived from an audiovisual medium. I'm afraid we need all to take a deep collective breath and accept the increasing centrality of the moving image at the very heart of learning, and the serious opportunities this offers to both the teacher and the learner. We also need to recognise that this is no longer simply about the power of narratives absorbed at the cinema or on television, but also about the power of image-supported and interactive information, downloaded on Xboxes, smartphones, netbooks and so on, in fact on every conceivable and convenient device possible. In the UK, there are now plenty of schools working with organisations like FutureLab, which I have the privilege of chairing, to develop classroom practices and new approaches to curriculum design, which are underpinned by the aim of supporting young people to become informed and literate digital participants. I think I'll repeat that phrase, to become informed and literate digital participants. Initiatives are being developed within schools that twin the application of new media for learning with fresh thinking about the curriculum and teaching practices. For example, by conducting historical inquiry via online archives, by interpreting and producing literary hypertext, by testing and constructing science simulations, all of which, quite inevitably, challenge what we teach, as well as how it's taught, and even to a degree, why it's taught. Let me offer an example of what I mean in relation to both the opportunities and the challenges by looking through the prism of the issue that affects every single person in this room, no matter where you're from, namely climate change, and in particular, a simulation game that's been developed for us in the UK. What's been fascinating to me, but maybe rather less surprising to many of you, is that the very first thing kids do when they get hold of these games is destroy the planet. It's only when they've done that a couple of times and look very hard at the repercussions do they go back and maybe the third or fourth time around begin to look at the issues involved in building an infinitely more sustainable model. Now, in many respects, this is little short of a revolution in the way that we learn. For a start, it's a lot less didactic, because instead of saying to kids, this is the way to do it, what you're in effect saying is, here are the tools and here are your options. If you like, it's the equivalent of learning to use a flight simulator. You take off, you try to stay in the air and eventually to land safely and in the right place. Assessment is immediate and self-evident. Safe flight and landing, success, crash, and you've failed. Now, kids don't need to be told whether they've succeeded or not. And what's interesting is, if they've failed, their most likely response is to want to try again and again and again until they get it right. In real life, that's exactly how we all learn. In fact, that's how people have always learned. But oddly, and this is purely my own observation, that type of thinking never seems to have quite transmitted itself to the established world of teaching and learning. Games, and crucially, their interactive dimension, provide us with the opportunity of looking at things as they are, or even were, and then through, as it were, reassembling the digital toolbox, offer a sense of how they might be or might become. You could call these games ethical and moral laboratories. As I see it, the development of this type of content affords a richness of imaginative thinking and the opportunity to learn of a type that was lost many, many years ago when we stopped making things with our hands by what we then knew as trial and error. Technologies handed us the opportunity to actively engage learners, to finally escape from the passive world of chalk and talk, which remained, even in 2010, an all-too-familiar model of classroom practice throughout much of the world. It's my sincere belief that today's digital media could have an enormously valuable impact in addressing many of the challenges that lie ahead of us, simply by more effectively spreading knowledge and understanding of the sheer complexity and interconnectedness of the physical world. I believe, for example, that intelligently developed digital media offers us a serious opportunity to help influence all manner of behavioural change. Uniquely, what we call games allow the possibility of creating differing scenarios to illustrate changes in climate and their likely variable impact upon ourselves and our planet. And if genuine creativity is brought into play, the possibilities in terms of richness and breadth of content contained in this one example alone are, in my judgment, almost boundless. As I've already said more than once, we in the developed world find ourselves in an environment literally saturated with moving and interactive images. They're the dominant means by which we increasingly learn about, understand, and hopefully begin to make some sense of the world. And in this new learning environment, mass participation in creating, sharing, and reusing images has taken hold on a quite extraordinary scale. Our task is surely to harness these opportunities in addressing the many, many longer-term challenges that we, as a global and digital society, now face. And with these long-term objectives in mind, I hope you'll allow me to finish with a bit of tough love by restating what I see as the crucial lessons that we living in Ireland ought to have absorbed during these past 30 years in considering what makes for a successful society in an ever more difficult world. Now, firstly, like it or not, getting education right is the whole ball of wax. Secondly, at risk of repeating myself, no education system can possibly be better than the teachers it employs and the standards that it demands of them. Thirdly, teacher training in a digital age has to be viewed as an entirely non-negotiable and continuing process. The commitment of governments and individual head teachers to the best possible quality of teacher training, along with regular, preferably annual, time out for professional development, must be absolute. Fourthly, there needs to be an undisputed global acceptance of the importance of the education of women. Educated women are the fulcrum around which can be built educated and healthy families, and those families will invariably be smaller and better cared for. There's no magic in any of this. Fifth, this country enjoyed an early and quite inspired start due to the courage and foresight of Donna O'Malley, who, in the mid-60s, when it was thoroughly unfashionable, laid the foundations for a strong public focus on education. His tragic early death was another in Ireland's history of all too often losing the best of its leaders before they're able to complete the goals that they've set themselves. But it was largely thanks to his imagination that this country was able to take a very early lead in encouraging its young people to embrace what was at the time not just new, but very largely untried technology. That gamble paid off, and a well-educated, returning diaspora had a lot to do with promoting 20 years of unparalleled growth. But I'd argue that those early successes were insufficiently built upon, to the point at which public expenditure on education, as a percentage of GDP, was allowed to drift downwards at the very moment that it should have been going up exponentially. A minimum, an absolute minimum of 7% of total GDP is the figure the government should set and hold to, because all other areas of public expenditure, including health, must be allocated by the Cabinet in such a way as to make that figure as quickly achievable as possible. A world-class education system will, over time, deliver a world-class health service. But the reverse could never, ever be possible. Sixth and last, although I could go on, young people learn and teachers learn best, teach best, in environments that they respect and which accord with what they see and admire in the best of the built environment around them. The physical infrastructure of many of the primary and secondary schools in Ireland should be a cause for national shame. And when I speak of infrastructure, I most specifically include every aspect of connectivity along with its complementary hardware and its software. Choices were made to spend billions of euros on buildings in the private and public sector, which now lie either empty, underused, or simply not needed. And it's my personal view that had some fraction of that sum been committed to refurbishing the quality of the schools and the classrooms in this country, the nation would be far better placed to dig itself out of the hole that all that accumulated debt and waste has helped to create. Now, the good news is that there are really excellent people in this country who understand that education at every level is both the cause and the consequence of any possibility of national renewal. For too long, Ireland relied on the good offices of the church and the largesse of Europe to address and solve many of these problems. I came here this morning to argue that, for good or ill, those days are over. And it's now down to a simple test of national will to invest in the future, to rediscover those things for which this country has rightly been celebrated: learning, culture, imagination, inventiveness, and a unique sense of community and place that the world has in the past, and please God, will once again come to admire, and who knows, possibly even envy. Thank you very much for listening to me.
What we have is a system that's shaped by historical forces, but they are now almost totally bankrupt as ideas for education in the 21st century. And I think they're betraying most of our children. Public systems of education paid for from taxation were invented to meet the needs of the industrial economy that was emerging in the 18th and 19th centuries, where we needed a workforce who could do certain sorts of things.
Our ordinary workmen have a tradition of skill behind them.
The high schools of today were essentially designed in the 19th century, and they reached their zenith in the 1950s. In the old days, we say one size fits all. Okay, 30 kids, put them in a classroom. We're going to teach them the same material. You're all expected to get it the same way.
Page 56, boy, page 56.
There's a great emphasis on lining up and bells and, you know, these vast movements from room to room, a bit like movement of vast tribes, really, all at key times, bottlenecks, putting children in age cohorts, regardless of whether that's got any purpose at all.
In the old days, it used to be the teacher as the man or woman, the person up front who knows it all. And here are these young people who are listening to this person who knows it all, and they take it all in, and if it's a good teacher, you know, you all get it and you move on.
I won't forget to tell you when it's time to stop, lad.
There's a tendency to look backwards.
Thank you, sir.
Always to say, well, there was a golden age of education, and if we just get back to that, you know, everybody will be absolutely fine, all wearing blazers and, you know, boaters and sort of doing reading, writing, arithmetic.
Potty bam, potty bass, potty bat.
Potty bam, potty bass, potty bat, cricket bat.
Schools become steeped in history, in the past, in static knowledge, and fail to capture the here and now. And schools often fail to prepare young people for contemporary society, for the realities of the world in which we are living. And even more significantly, fail to prepare young people for the emerging issues of our time.
How is this helping our children in terms of what they're going to be as adults in 25 years' time, a time we don't really know what it's going to be like? How adaptable are they going to be? How versatile are they going to be? And how confident are they going to be?
students who are starting school this year are likely to be retiring around 2065. Given that we can't predict with any certainty what the world's going to look like in 10 years or even perhaps 5 years, the very best that we can do is prepare young people for a rapidly changing social, technological, economic environment, that they'll need to be the most flexible, collaborative, resilient, creative generation that really have ever been.
Education is I really think, it's the most fundamental challenge facing human beings, you know, that education will be the key to solving all of the other problems that we've got.